everybody can grab their seats, we'll get started.
Good morning.
I don't think we were expecting everybody to sit down so quickly. So thank you. I guess we all know that we've got a lot to pack in the next hour and a half or so. So let me get us started. BrandBank welcomes you to the forum for the Georgia 6th District. Excuse me. My name is Chris Gruehn. I'm the Cobb Market President for Brand. We opened an office off of George Busby Parkway late last year and have been looking for a way to start serving our communities that we're serving from that office. And we thought this was a great opportunity to do that. So thank you for being here. If you know Brand, you know that we like to invest in the communities where we have offices and where our people live and work, and we hope that you will find this event today as a service to you and our community. So please enjoy yourself today. At this time, I would like to ask everybody to stand who is able to say the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Les will get started, and we will be back to you shortly. Also like to thank Wes Moss. Wes Moss is going to be our moderator today. If you don't know Wes Moss, you must not listen to WSB. He hosts Money Matters. He also is Chief Investment Strategist of Capital Investment Advisors, which manages $1.5 billion. He is also author of You Can Retire Sooner Than You Think. Many of you picked up that at the front. There are copies out there, and I'm sure he'll sign it nicely. And he is also a contributor to ClarkHoward.com. Third, we've got some partners in the room, the North Fulton Chamber, the Cobb Chamber, the Metro Chamber, also the Foundation for Northeast Georgia. We appreciate all of our sponsors, and thanks for participating with us in this. This is a little unusual, a corporation or a bank sponsoring an event. We would like to thank one of our directors from Cobb County, Connie Engel, that's sitting up here. Connie, if you're just waving or doing a little quick. This was Connie's idea, and we ran with it. I thank Margaret Whieldon for running with it. Margaret works, and she's in charge of our marketing at BrandBank, and we appreciate Margaret for running with it. Everything looks great today. Thank you. So what attracted us to this event is the fact that it was a non-partisan event, and that we were supporting both all Republicans, Democrats, and Independents as a bank in the area that the district was in. So we want to make sure that as a community bank in Atlanta that we give back to this community and that we support this community. So many of you in Cobb probably have not heard about BrandBank, but let me give you a little background on Brand before I get off. We are a 112-year-old bank based out of Gwinnett County. We're $2.4 billion, which puts us as one of the larger community banks in the Atlanta market. We have one office in Cobb County, which is up on George Worth Busby Boulevard across from Kennesaw State, State University. We do everything. We're a full-service bank. We'll offer you a commercial loan for your business. If you need a mortgage loan, we've got our mortgage shop. We have two heads of our mortgage shop. One is in Gwinnett County and one is in Cobb. Alex Koutouzis is in Cobb. Alex, you want to raise your hand there? Thanks, Alex, for everything he does for Brand Mortgage. You can open a checking account. You can make your investments. We are a full-service bank. If you're tired of the big banks or your smaller bank can't service you, Brand Bank can service you. We appreciate everything that this community does for us, and we will give back to this community. Thank you, and I'll let Wes Moss start the debate. Appreciate it.
Good afternoon, and thanks for being here so much. And we've got candidates right outside, and we've got the main event just about to get started. So I think what we'll do here, and again, thank you, Bartow, for the invitation to host this. We've got WSB is here covering the event. We've got Fox News is here, the AP. So we've got lots of press today. We're also broadcasting this on Facebook Live. We're going to talk about Twitter in just a minute. You've got some Twitter handles on your table here, but a big thank you to the folks at BrandBank, Bartow, Margaret, Whieldon, and her crew. The BrandBank folks stand up just a minute. If you have a green sash on, I'd like you to stand up. Because evidently what's happened here. Like the Brand Bank is going to start an airline. And Bartow, is that the long-term forecast for y'all? Because I think it's a good idea. Air Brand is what we're looking for. But it's a good-looking group, and I really appreciate everyone having me today. Again, Metroland Chamber, Greater North Fulton Chamber, Cobb Chamber. And again, this right now is broadcast on, welcome to all those watching on Facebook Live. If you're on Wes Moss Money Matters, which is our Facebook page, this event and all the candidates and everything that they're going to say, they're going to be live. So there's a lot to get to today. Without further ado, let's get to the main event. I'd like a round of applause as we bring in all 18 candidates. So let's bring them in. Donald Trump, there's a pretty good chance that he's watching Twitter. So we have a very good chance he's watching Twitter. So as we go through today, the hashtag for this particular event and the election as a whole, and we want this to get attention, the hashtag is GA District 6. And that's on these cards. If you forget that, they're on table. So throughout today, as many tweets as you would like to tweet, the more the merrier. And again, at GA District 6. So with that, the other thought here is that these guys have a tough job, and I think Congress has a tough job. I was on Real Clear Politics the other day looking at congressional approval. And in this summer, congressional approval was at 12% in America. So it was at 12% approval. And over the last several months, it's risen. I'm not going to say it skyrocketed, but it's all the way up to 19% today. So, you know, the good news is for y'all, there's a lot of room for improvement once y'all makes it to Washington. So, with that, here's a quick overview of how we're doing. We have 9 main questions. The first section is about healthcare, then we're going to move to taxes, then we're moving more to other key policy questions. We're going to do an introduction, 1 minute apiece for each candidate. Then when we get to questions, we're going to have 1 minute per candidate per table. So one question will be per table. There is a time clock right here, obviously, candidates. If we go way over because of the sheer number of y'all, we're going to be here for 3 or 4 hours. So let's try to keep our responses to 1 minute. There'll be some room for debate. But we really want to get you all to give us your clear position, as we have a lot of undecided voters here. I've talked to several people today that are waiting to hear from you candidates to make their decision on who they're really going to vote for. So let's keep that in mind as well. So with that, plus I also have a bell. And if it goes way over, I'm not afraid to use the bell. With that, let's start with our first question here. We're going to start at the center table. We're going to try to mix this up as evenly as we can. I'm going to start with table 2, and the first question we're going to start with is for John Ossoff. John, would you, and we're going to do introductions first, so let's start with here's the next thought. We're going to start on, I'm so eager to hear from you guys. So we're going to start with table 2 on introductions. So Dr. Bouillon, we're going to start with you. We're going to pass the mic over to the left, and then we'll move to table 1. Go ahead.
Ready?
Yes, you can go at any point. And your 1 minute is taken.
Well, when I start, right?
Just please introduce yourself.
I would like to thank BrandBank and everybody for coming here today. I'm Muhammad Ali, lightweight. If I am elected, I'll fight like heavyweight in Washington, D.C. for you. I'm running for U.S. Congress because I would like to give back. I want to give back to the community. I want to serve the 6th District. I came to this country in 1986 when Ronald Reagan was president. It took me 14 years and a lot of John Wayne movies to become the citizen of this country finally. And I did it the right way. I came to America because I believe in America and American dream. I'm a proud American and I believe in the liberty and justice for all. This country has given me a lot of opportunities. My family and I have benefited tremendously. So this is my turn to give back to the community and make sure that this country moves in the right direction. As an economist, I understand what needs to be done. As a concerned citizen, I understand what needs to be done. So on April 18th, I hope you will consider voting for me. I'm at the top of the ballot, Muhammad Ali. You cannot miss it. Thank you so much.
Hello, my name is David Abrams. Tell you real briefly about myself. I'm a CPA by training. I was a tax accountant for about 3 years, and then I started a business converting vehicles to run on clean domestic natural gas. So I did that for about 6 years, and now I've ventured into politics. And the reason why I decided to run in this race is because I think we have some serious challenges in this country. I think that in Washington, we just mentioned about the low approval rating of Congress. And that's because there's too much fighting, there's not enough talking, there's not enough trying to actually solve problems for the people of this country. It's all about politics and one-upping people. Now, I am a conservative. I believe in free markets, limited government. I think the market forces are the best thing to improve the lot of the ordinary man. Milton Friedman is probably one of my biggest mentors. I believe in these principles very deeply. But that being said, in order to govern effectively, it cannot be a blood sport. We have to be able to find ways that we can work together and solve these challenging problems in Washington. Our debt is absolutely under control. And if we don't do something about that, if we don't do something about tax reform, if we don't do something about healthcare, these are serious problems, and we are gonna leave the next generation worse off. And I'm not prepared to do that. I'm prepared to go to Washington and stand up for liberty and fight for these principles that are so important to us, but also work together. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Karen Handel, and I want to add my thanks to BrandBank and to the various chambers who are sponsoring today. I think we've had a lot of talk out of Washington, and what we need is a doer, someone who is going to go to Washington and actually deliver for you. I have a track record of delivering and getting things done. Many of you in this room know me. You know that my career is anchored in the private sector. I took those skills to the Fulton County Commission, where I faced a $100 million budget deficit, balanced it without a tax increase, when few thought I could, and did that without a Republican majority. When you gave me the privilege of being your Secretary of State, I was able to get photo ID implemented, and today that law, photo ID, stands as one of the best examples of election security in this country. That's the kind of leadership that I'm going to take to Washington. Someone who is going to deliver, finally, on repealing and replacing Obamacare, on tax reform, securing our borders, reducing taxes, and finally getting a balanced budget and taking on this debt. So I look forward to answering the questions. Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Wes. Thanks to BrandBank and the participating chambers and everyone who's here to hear from the candidates. My name is John Ossoff. I'm a native son of Georgia, went to Georgetown University's School of Foreign Service, where I studied international relations. I worked on Capitol Hill for 5 years, specializing in defense and national security policy. Saw the legislative process, saw how constituent service and congressional oversight can be rendered, and also saw why Washington is broken, the corruption, the partisanship, the gridlock. Decided to leave. In 2012, I got a master's degree from the London School of Economics, and now I run a small business that specializes in anti-corruption and organized crime investigations, producing documentary films for major international broadcasters. I am running a positive campaign that is focused like a laser on our local economic development. The high-tech, biotech, and medical research sectors can make North Metro Atlanta the Silicon Valley of the South if we can get beyond partisanship and focus on solutions like expanding export markets, cutting wasteful spending, prioritizing research and development. And a member of Congress can also be an ambassador for our business community, attracting new facilities, headquarters, and research centers from growing organizations. I would be honored to serve you in that capacity in Congress. Thank you.
I'm Dan Moody, and I was first elected as a conservative Republican to the Georgia State Senate in 2002. I had been an Army officer. I had owned my own business. I had helped create some great Georgia jobs, and I pumped millions of dollars into our economy, just like some of you have. I had always wanted to have an opportunity to become a public servant. And in 2002, Georgia became a red state. But you know what happened? A lot of people realized it was time to govern. And new leaders emerged at the Capitol. And I was one of them. My caucus elected me as their chairman. I helped do a lot of hefty lifting. And together we took a huge surplus that we had inherited from the Democrats, over $600 million, and we turned it into a $500 million surplus. I had always believed in term limits. And you know what I did? After four terms, I term limited myself. I went home to live under the laws that I helped create. And today in Washington, it's time to govern. And folks, we've just got to get it right. Because if we don't, as Republicans, we may never get another chance. I'm all for hard work. I learned how to do it in the Army, and I'm ready to do it again. But one thing you won't get from me, I'll never be a career politician. I really want to earn your vote. Thank you.
Good afternoon. How's everyone doing today? Good, good. My name is Reagan Willard Edwards. I currently reside in the 6th District in East Cobb, and I actually graduated high school in East Cobb as well. Then got the Hope Scholarship and went to Georgia Tech. Moved up to D.C. and worked for a presidential appointee as well as for the Department of Energy. Currently, I work at a global financial services firm that deals with big data. And I've had a lot of time and I have a lot of understanding about the technological landscape that we're currently living in. I'm currently a member of the ACLU, TAG, the Technology Association of Georgia, and I have been for a while, Women in Technology, as well as the Sales Management Association. I'm a professional and I'm a mother of two girls. I say all this to tell you that I have perspective. I understand what it means to buy the milk and to work in corporate America. I understand what businesses need to thrive, and that's what I want to give to those business owners of the 6th District. I want you to continue to thrive, and I want you to soar. So on April 18th or before, definitely put your vote in for Reagan Edwards, because I'm here for you.
Thank you, Reagan. We're going to go to table one here. We're going to go to Keith Brower.
Hi, thanks everybody for being here today. My name is Keith Brower, and I'm running for Congress because I believe we desperately need leaders in Congress of courage and integrity. So I'm originally from Dunwoody. I graduated from Marist and then went to Duke University. While there, I joined the Air Force ROTC program, and after graduation, I became an officer in the Air Force, went to pilot training in Valdosta, and have been flying airplanes in the Air Force for about 14 years, up until I became a candidate. I've lived all over the country, I've lived all over the world, including Korea and Eastern Europe, where I worked with NATO. And I flew 497 combat sorties in Iraq and Afghanistan during four deployments. And I did all that because I believe in the nobility of serving a cause greater than yourself. And that's what I think we're desperately missing in Washington. You know, we need fighters who are gonna stand up to the special interest, who are gonna fight to control the growth of government, and who are gonna make the hard decisions that are necessary to move America forward. And until we start electing different people, people who have the values to stand up for those principles, I think we're gonna continue to see congressional approval at 19 or 12%. Thank you very much. The name is Keith Broward.
Hi, I'm Andre Pollard, and I'm running as an independent for Congress. I am a technologist. I am part of the resist movement. I got up off my sofa, and feeling of helplessness, I decided I'm gonna, you know, run for Congress, and I hope my run is inspirational to others that anyone can run for Congress. I'm a father of four kids. I'm an immigrant. I immigrated here when I was 11 years old. My wife is Latino from Dominican Republic. I am all of you. I run the Alpharetta Ventures and Incubator Meetup Group, which meets in the Alpharetta Technology Center. And we have a startup coming out called WorkAlert.com. I'm a mechanical engineer. I work for a large telecom company. And my main goal is to get more women in technology, more legacy force in technology, promote the American brand, defend the American brand from anyone, promote startups and small businesses, and develop those future skills for a technology future. Thank you.
My name is Bob Gray, and quite candidly, I'm running to save the American dream. When I was a boy, my grandparents imprinted on me three fundamental American values: self-reliance, independence, and personal responsibility. And as I watch TV and go about my day, I see that we as a country have drifted so far from those American values, And I think the solution is to change the way we do business in Washington, D.C. I grew up in Buffalo, New York, Rust Belt kid. Went and had graduated from Purdue University with an engineering degree. Went to the University of Chicago, received my MBA in finance. Spent the next 30 years in the technology industry on the management team of multi-billion dollar companies. I now have invested in a local startup. I know as a member of that board what it is to risk your own capital and to struggle to make payroll. Very different skill set than that when you're working for a Global 1000 company. So I have both perspectives. What I want to do is focus on results in DC, and we're just not seeing that happen for the American people. Economic issues, the debt, and national security. I have a particular interest in cybersecurity. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Ron Slotin. I served two terms in the Georgia State Senate. I was on the education committee and I helped pass the Hope Scholarship. Can I see a sign of hands of how many families have been helped by the Hope Scholarship in this room? That was the best program that the state's ever passed, and I'll remind you that we had a Democratic governor, Democratic State House, and Democratic State Senate when we passed that legislation. We got a lot of things done when I was in the state senate. We lowered state taxes. We gave teachers the pay raise they deserve. We grew the economy. We expanded the World Congress Center. I worked with the Metro Chamber of Commerce to bring infrastructure improvements to Atlanta for the Olympic Games. These are the issues that the Democratic Party needs to run on. After politics, I opened a business in Sandy Springs. I had an advertising agency. I helped start the Sandy Springs Chamber of Commerce. When I was with my advertising agency, I was part of the business development team that created the 2009 entertainment tax credit that has resulted in thousands of jobs in the state of Georgia. Just in 2016, there was over 240 TV and movie productions generating over $7 billion in economic development. I have a record of results. A lot of people talk about doing things. I have a record of results for creating jobs, growing the economy, improving our education. It doesn't matter if you're a Democrat, Independent, or Republicans. Those are issues that affect everybody in the district. Those are issues that will help people in the district, and those are issues that I'm going to get results on. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Amy Kramer. I am a former flight attendant and real estate agent and one of the founders of the Modern Day Tea Party movement. I'm not the party of no. I want common sense conservative solutions in Washington, D.C. And I'm running because I got involved, I guess, about 8 or 9 years ago when I was sick and tired of yelling at my TV and radio, and I got off my couch and decided to do something about it. And this movement started across the country. I feel like Washington is out of control. The federal government has gotten too big. They're more and more involved in our lives. And this country is exceptional. The people are exceptional. What nobody talks about anymore is opportunity. We need to get the government out of our lives and let the American people and our small businesses thrive. And I think that we are headed that direction under President Trump. But I think we need more citizen legislators in Washington, D.C. As I've traveled across the country, I've encouraged others to go out there and run. And when Tom Price was appointed HHS Secretary, and I've lived in this district my entire life. I was born in Kennestone Hospital and lived here my entire life. How can I go out and encourage others to do something if I'm not doing it myself? I would like to see a woman elected to the seat because the GOP, to my knowledge, has never elected a woman to a federal seat nor to governor. And I think it's time that we need more women in Washington, D.C. One thing about women is we don't sit around and talk about how to get things done. We just go out and do it. And that's what I want to do.
Ron, I think that was a good idea to stand up. We're used to standing up at all these, so forgive me. My name is Kurt Wilson, candidate for the 6th Congressional District. There's a lot of outstanding people on this stage, and if I were sitting in your shoes, I'd be saying, who do I vote for and why? And so let me give you my bio. It's incredibly impressive. I'm an ordinary citizen just like you. And that's significant, because everyone in this room knows the one obvious truth, and everyone on this stage knows the one obvious truth. Washington, D.C. is badly broken, and it's got to be fixed. And it can't be fixed on the margins. It's got to be fixed with a reformation of big ideals. a reformation that we have to reverse the $20 trillion of national debt, a reformation that we have to begin balancing the budget with a surplus, a reformation that we have to repeal the 16th Amendment and replace it with a flat tax or a fair tax, a reformation, most importantly, that we have to derail and defund the federal bureaucracy and return the power back to the people. So I'm running for one simple reason. It's to bring the get the government off the backs of the people. My name is Kurt Wilson. Thank you.
We're going to go down to table three with Alexander Hernandez.
Hello, everyone. My name is Alexander Hernandez, and I am the only truly independent out of the field of 18 candidates here, meaning I've already put the district before Nancy Pelosi and Paul Ryan, and I mean it. I ran on a People First platform, but I'm glad to see there's bipartisanship happening with both Mr. Gray and John here trying to buy the election. We're doing it a little different, and our People First platform does that. We make sure that we focus on the economy first and foremost. And how do we do that? We invest in people through infrastructure and education. Infrastructure for jobs now, education for growth into the future. We follow what President Dwight D. Eisenhower did with the interstate system. We have poisoned waterway systems, roads, bridges that all need upgrading, and that's a lot of jobs. We put people to work right now. Second point, we look at our veterans and we give them a raise. And how are we going to pay for it? Cutting the waste at the Pentagon. Over $6.5 trillion has been lost over there over the past 10 years, and Congress has not lifted a finger. If I go to Congress, I will make sure we start finding that money and we hold people accountable. Congress should check the purse, and I will make sure we do it. And then finally, healthcare. Healthcare's been in the news lately. The thing is, the partisans won't tell you is they're not going to do the real. They're not going to go after the real problem. It's just band-aid solutions and kicking the can down the road. Both failures of plans. The ACA was a failure. It's Heritage Foundation's plan. Our plan focuses on the people. Right now, today, we could repeal and replace Obamacare with H.R. 676. It's in Congress right now. It's been introduced. We pass that, repeal, replace. We lift the burden off of small businesses from providing health care, stimulate the economy, and boost, and it helps everyone. YourVoteGeorgia.com is my website, and I hope I can count on y'all support. Thank you.
Alexander Hernandez, first one to start heating things up. Thank you for that. Richard Keatley.
My name is Richard Keatley. I'm running for change, change in the form and content of our political discourse. I think like a lot of people here, I've been frustrated by the partisan bickering and the lack of concrete results. I am not a politician, but I've always been a public servant. I spent 7 years in the United States Navy as a naval officer serving my country, first on a surface warfare ship and then in Naples, Italy. In the Navy, I learned two lessons. One was the strength of our nation's great diversity, and the other was the importance of America's role in the world as a force of stability and democracy. And I intend as a congressman to defend those two principles. As your congressman, I would emphasize, for the past 12 years I've been an educator. I teach at Georgia State University. I teach Italian and French. I did my PhD eventually at Yale University. I, as your congressman, would concentrate on three things: education, national security, and the jobs of the future. I think these three aspects are the things that we most need to concentrate on in the 6th District and as a country. In education, of course, we know our high schools are behind other schools in this country, in Georgia, and the United States is behind other countries in the world. And we need a strong education to enable our democracy and our economy to move forward. In the 6th District, I would create a jobs leadership task force involving the different communities that are now separate and try to work toward creating the jobs of the future. I'm Richard Keatley from Tucker, Georgia. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Judson Hill. I'm a senator and legislator, citizen legislator, and I've served many of y'all for a number of years, but I've also been a small business owner, and I served with President Reagan in the White House. And through those years, I've learned about the issues that are important to you because America is struggling, and the families and the businesses of this community are really struggling. America, I believe, is at a crossroads, a major crossroads. But I think we need a conservative reformer who can stand up for you every single day. We need a trusted reformer, a trusted conservative, someone who has the principles and the values that you represent, someone who stood up for you to defend those values in the face of special interest and in the political establishment, been punished because they stood up to defend your values. I think it's time that we send someone back to Washington, D.C. that has that proven record and track record. You know, everyone before you is going to stand and say what they'll do. But before you listen to them, before you vote for them, make them prove to you. Make them show you what they have done. Make them show you what they have done. What have they done with tax policy and regulatory policy and immigration and standing up for our military? What have they done for you with Obamacare? Because the difference in this race is there's only one person, and that's me. I'm a trusted, principled, conservative reformer. I've advanced those measures. These are serious measures that are critically important to you. I've always put you first. If you remember two things today, remember this. You have a proven conservative reformer, someone who stood up to defend those values, and Fox News showed that I'm the only Republican who can beat the Democrat, and Nancy Pelosi is coming to take the seat back. Thank you very much.
Hello, I want to thank you all for inviting me today and speaking before you. My name is Dr. Rebecca Quigg. I'm a cardiologist and heart transplant specialist. I'm a lifelong patient care advocate and an expert on the Affordable Care and health care reform. Throughout my 25 years of practicing medicine, I saw things deteriorate with insurance coverage. People started with getting the same care, irrespective of their socioeconomic group and whether they had insurance or not. And by the 2000s, if you had a stub toe, you could not get insurance because that was a pre-existing. I left my full-time job to start a consulting business and care for my son with disabilities. I was not insurable for 5 years until I was able to purchase an ACA policy. I followed this law as it was passed through Congress. I helped enroll people, and I've seen what's happened to the Affordable Care Act over the last 4 years. There have been so many things that we have could have changed and amended, but the Congress was in gridlock and refused to do so. What I want to do is go to Congress with my experience and background in the healthcare and healthcare reform to work in a bipartisan way to improve this law. We need to get premiums, deductibles, prescription drug prices down for individuals, families, businesses. We need to make Medicare stronger, not a voucher system. And you need a doctor in a house that knows the background as to how to do this, because we don't have enough doctors there, and I believe we need a woman doctor in the house to do this. Thank you.
My name is Bruce Lavelle, and I'm running for the Georgia 6th Congressional District. And I wish I had a lot more time, but I'll just get straight to it. I'm running because of government overreach. My family, my business, some of the small business, I recognize a lot of bankers that have been moved around from various banks. I was a victim of government overreach, part of the TARP money that caused a catastrophe in my household. And one of the reasons why it was a catastrophe, because a lot of our elected officials and our leaders were on the take with special interests, and they did nothing to help the people except help themselves. I am the candidate that will publicly disavow all PACs. I will, especially Club for Growth. I will not take money from lobbyists. There's nothing on my campaign, nor am I trying to self-fund like some other guys trying to buy the seat. I'm absolutely, totally clear of any appearance of impropriety. I will fight for you. I know what it feels like for some of you folks that went through 2008 crash and trying to rebound. I recognize a lot of y'all that are trying to come out of that catastrophe. The one thing I bring, I started with President Trump in 2015. I know him very well. I know all the folks in the White House. I want to fight for you to bring those transportation dollars. 285 and 400 and I-85 corridor is rated the worst corridor in the nation. I was a chairman at MARTA. I have a tremendous amount of experience on all types of boards. The list goes on. I see the time's up. But I'm the candidate. You will have to worry about me. I'm not on the take for anyone. And that's Bruce Lavelle. You can Google me, Bruce Lavelle, and you'll see everything about me. I'm an open book. Thanks for having me. Thank you. Bruce.
I want to recognize BrandBank, thank you, and the chambers for putting this together. I'm William Lopp, I'm running the 6th District. I am not a career politician, rather my career has led me to politics. I'm the best candidate for the job because I've spent over 30 years as a small business owner, as a licensed CPA, advising small business owners and Americans. I am completely aware of how middle-income Americans are paying the most tax. I was born right here in the 6th District. I'm the middle brother of 11 siblings with 62% Republicans and 38% Democrat in my family, as well as our district. Our dinner conversations get quite problematic, yet, in the end, an agreement and understanding is reached, I learned at a very early age to work with others and negotiate issues. My number one goal as a CPA is to reduce taxes and regulations. I will be able to serve as your congressman as a bipartisan candidate, with both sides of the coin being discussed and studied. A decision will be reached with compromise and good results for both sides. I am the only candidate that has details on where I stand on real issues facing our district and our country. Please visit my website, search LOP, L-L-O-P for Congress. Thank you.
We're going to start out with this. We're going to go right to healthcare. A lot of us mentioned healthcare on the stage. There's a tweet one day ago from Donald J. Trump. Again, if you're tweeting this today, it's at Real Donald Trump. The Democrats will make a deal with me on healthcare as soon as Obamacare folds. Not long. Don't worry, we're in very good shape. Let's start with John Ossoff. John, would you have supported the GOP change to health care, and if not, why, and is President Trump right or not?
I will go to Washington to work with anyone to promote a health care policy that serves three basic principles. One, no American should suffer or die from treatable or preventable illness. Two, no one should go broke because they get sick. And three, no business should have to downsize or lay off employees because of increasing premiums. The bill that was moving through Congress, I would not have supported because it would have thrown 24 million Americans off of their health insurance and back into the emergency room at taxpayer expense, by the way. It would have increased costs significantly, especially for folks 50 to 64. And it would have gutted the CDC, where we have critical pandemic prevention and health security infrastructure that's essential to our national security. So I think 7 years now after the passage of the Affordable Care Act, we need to break out of this partisan trench warfare and do the nuts and bolts legislating necessary to get more people insured, to provide more affordable choices to consumers. If that means more competition across state lines, if that means small business tax credits, if that means repeal of the medical device tax, those are all things I'm willing to consider.
Okay, Karen, please next. Karen Handel. Again, I think that there's certainly frustration among not just Democrats but Republicans that nothing got done over the last several weeks with health care. How do you change the bill? Would you have supported the GOP change?
You know, once again, Congress failed to deliver on its promise, its commitment to not only the people of the 6th, but to Americans. For 6 years, 6 years, there was talk of repealing and replacing, and we had the opportunity to do it. Was the bill perfect? No. But I would not have allowed the pursuit of perfection to keep us from doing that repeal and replace and moving forward with some progress for businesses and American families. Obamacare has been the single biggest intrusion into our lives in my lifetime. It is telling us who our doctors are going to be. Our premiums have skyrocketed. Congress made a promise to the people of this country. They failed to deliver. As your congressman for the 6th District, I will deliver because I understand how to get things done and my track record shows it.
David.
Well, you know, I think the whole process was ill-conceived. I think it was poorly run. You know, as a business owner, something that I've learned is it's always best, if you're coming up to a deadline, it's always best to talk to your customer and say, look, you know, if we're going to miss a deadline, it's better to make sure you get it right than to try to rush something through and for it to be wrong. And I think the leadership in Congress felt the political pressure, felt the media pressure to just try to have something there. It wasn't ready. There wasn't consensus. You know, before Obamacare was passed, there was never a major piece of legislation that did not have bipartisan support. And in my opinion, that's one of the reasons why Obamacare has failed. It didn't have bipartisan support. It didn't have support of the American people, and we should not repay the favor. I think that we need to be able to bring a consensus together so that we can lower premiums for American families that are suffering. I don't like the approach of the government regulating what kind of insurance people can buy. We need to have a broad-based consensus, and that's what I would work towards in Congress. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Bouillon, as you continue on this, as a Republican, would you have voted? Would you have voted for the bill, or would you have stood with the Freedom Caucus? And what is your thought?
No, I would not have voted for this bill because this was not ready. That was clear from the Congressional Budget Office, the Republican governors, even a significant number of Republican lawmakers. The Obamacare had serious issues, problems. As you know, this was done without bipartisan support, and that's one of the problems still we're facing. There are some good things about Obamacare, keeping kids up to 26 and pre-existing condition, but the premiums have skyrocketed. The deductibles have been too high. Those are two major issues that needs to be dealt with, which were not dealt with in the new bill. So I would support a bill that would lower the premium and lower the deductible and ensure health care for every citizen of the country.
Let's move to Dan Moody. Again, I know a lot of you candidates are saying we're going to reduce premiums, but the problem here is that no matter what bill we introduce, it's a very difficult task. So do you think that that's a possibility, Dan?
Thank you, Wes. You know, first of all, Obamacare is an absolute disaster. It's going to bankrupt the country if we don't repeal and replace it. Now, unlike what I've heard so far, I actually know how arduous of a process it is to pass legislation. I've been there and I've done it. And folks, it's like making sausage. You have to perfect it once it starts. In this particular case, this was the beginning of a three-step process that the speaker rolled out. This bill would have changed if it had gotten started. I would have supported it, and I would have worked hard to make sure it became more and more perfect. I would have voted yes. Thank you, Wes.
Reagan. Again, the CBO report for healthcare as legislation was presented showed that over time, there would be less people insured over a decade period. There's a big difference between less people insured than the plan dropping people. So I think that it's difficult for the public to interpret what the news says about healthcare, what the CBO report says. How do you get even one vote on the Democratic side to vote yes to change Obamacare? Or are you fine with it the way it is?
No, I definitely think it needs some tweaking, but I don't believe in repeal and replace. I think that what Ryan and 45 put before earlier this week was horrible. Especially it attacked women. It took away maternity and newborn care, which as a woman with a two-year-old daughter, if you know, I was working when I had my daughter, but if I had to have a different type of health care, that would have been detrimental to my family. And you know, I think that women need a place in government. We are not equally, we don't have an equal distribution of women in government. And I think these are the types of things that are attacked because of that. We need to make sure our voices are heard as women. We need to speak loudly about these things, and attacking maternity and attacking newborn health care is atrocious. I would have never voted for it. I would have stood up here and filibustered if I could have.
Thank you, Reagan. We're going to go to table three. I want to start with Judson Hill, please. Judson, again, as another tweet from Donald Trump in the same day, the Republican House Freedom Caucus was able to snatch defeat from the jaws of victory. After so many bad years, they were ready for a win. Again, how do you, as a Republican, how do you unify the party if you end up in Washington?
One way you unify the party is doing the right thing from the very beginning. You actually stand up on our values, you defend our conservative principles, you defend the values of our constituents. I've done that every day for you as a senator here in East Cobb where I live, as well as across Sandy Springs. The difference between everybody else here is I've got a proven record of doing that. I've stood up to you when the times are tough. Related to Obamacare and this legislation, I would have introduced a comprehensive bill. I would have introduced the bill with a vision. I would have cast the vision to get government out of control and to expand choice and to make healthcare more affordable, more patient-centered. I'm the only one sitting here with that proven record here. Everybody else, for everyone else here, that's just talk. For me, it's not, because I've delivered on those promises. I wrote the legislation 9 years ago to buy insurance across state lines. Yes, we started that in Georgia. I wrote legislation to stop the expansion of Obamacare. We probably saved over $2 billion for the people of Georgia because we wanted to put patients first. I've written 8 model health care bills. That's the difference here in this race. You've got to get somebody who knows how to get this done, who actually doesn't just know it, doesn't just talk about it, has that proven record of accomplishing and being successful and delivering for the people. That's the difference between everyone here. For everyone else to just talk, I've proven that I've gotten the job done for you.
All right, we're moving to the right. Richard Keatley, as a Democrat, again, I just ran some numbers for a family of four for an Obamacare plan in the state of Georgia, anywhere from $1,100 a month to almost $1,700 a month. These are just real numbers, guys. And when you've got a median family, that's over $20,000 a year, median family income of $51,000 to $52,000. Again, how do you fix the system? Is there a silver bullet?
I do not believe there's a silver bullet. There are obviously problems that are systemic to our medical care system in this country, in which you receive a bill, it says $12,000 was the cost, and $2,000 is what the insurance company paid, and you're gonna pay $213, and none of them add up, and no one knows where these formulae are coming from. So the Affordable Care Act does have the fundamental problem of not having addressed the cost problem in the United States. We're 19th in the world for the quality of our care, and we pay twice as much as other nations to get the same quality of care. So if we, long term, I believe that the Affordable Care Act went in the right direction in getting people covered, but it didn't address that fundamental problem that we have in our healthcare system that needs to be addressed.
Thank you. Alexander Hernandez.
All right, a couple points on that. I want to just address what Mr. Hill said. He had the opportunity to expand Medicaid and refused to do that. Played party over country politics, refusing $34 billion on the table. That was money that could have helped rural hospitals, but unfortunately, he played politics. You've proven that, sir. On another point, I want to go now to what we can do. Why is there no replacement for ACA? Because ACA is the Heritage Foundation's plan. That's why there's no replace. But there is a plan right now to replace the ACA. H-676 will take the burden off of small businesses. Businesses will no longer have to provide health care. That will stimulate the economy. That is there right now. We can do it today. But unfortunately, both parties, again, beholden to the contributors, beholden to Pill Hill, beholden to the industries. I'm not going to be like that. I'm going to face these problems head on, regardless of what happens. I'm not trying to make any friends. That's why I'm also for term limits. I'm also for term limits because I'm not going to jockey to be the chairman of this or that other committee. I'm going to go there to work with whoever from either side who wants to really work for the people, will form coalitions, and will send a clear message to Washington and the country that we need something different, and that's what this campaign's about.
Alexander, thank you. And I believe you when you say you're not trying to make any friends. All right, let's go to Dr. Quay.
This is standing up powerful talk right now. I'm the only one here running for this office that really understands the Affordable Care Act and health care reform. Right now, 40 million people in this country have Affordable Care Act policies or coverage. 500,000 in the state of Georgia and 42,000 in District 6. Are we talking about trying to take this away from those 42,000 people? I don't think so. This law wasn't perfect. All we had to do after the first enrollment period in 2014 is start making changes and amendments. That's what happened with Medicare, that's what happened with Medicaid. There were amendments. As things were a problem, they were fixed. But we had gridlock in Congress. And I will tell you about premiums. If you look at states like California and New York, who fully embraced this law from the beginning and started their own exchanges and expanded Medicaid, their premium increases were 3.2, 3.6%. In Georgia, Humana asked for 65% increase, and they don't get what they want, and they take their ball and run away. Instead of our state legislature holding their feet to the fire and saying, show us your books, why do you need 65%? We just let them have it. We have some of the highest premiums in the country, except for maybe Arizona. Those states all wanted to make this law fail, and that's not appropriate. These are people's lives. I care for thousands of critically ill patients, and those that don't have insurance can die. When we didn't expand Medicaid in this state, we turned down $3.8 billion over 3 years. Governor Deal says, oh, it cost us $2.1 million. I'm sorry, I'm not a mathematician, but I think that the math shows that we needed to get that money. 14,000 people die a year in the state of Georgia because we didn't expand Medicaid. All of the 19 states that didn't expand it, there are statistics. These are real people. And it's not just those that don't want to work. These are people that need Medicaid for nursing home care, for disabilities, for substance abuse. You know, we're all one job away from needing an Affordable Care Act policy.
Rebecca, I'm going to let Bruce respond to this. I mean, you bring up a good point. Part of the problem is that we have fewer and fewer insurance companies remaining. So I want to say that brings up insurance and the sale of insurance or healthcare insurance across state lines. Let's pass the microphone to Bruce, please, and have you respond to that.
Well, you asked the question, if I vote and I'd say yes. Everyone else danced around, and that's what you get with the same
thank
old
you,
same.
By the way. Thanks, Bruce.
So I just say
answer.
Yes.
I like
and
that.
I'm going to tell you the reason why is because I know Dr. Price, one of his former staff members, is actually on my team when they started the compilation trying to figure out a plan to help this blood that's gushing, especially for small businesses like me, going from $900 to $1,600 a month, is strangling, is chokeholding us. The thing back when I was an RNC delegate at the time, I was actually on that transition, picking Dr. Price to be the forefront on this. And President Trump took his plan, which is Dr. Price is a very well-known orthopedic surgeon, who, I want to remind you, took a compilation of RNs, other folks in his industry, and came up with this plan. The president said, I want to hurry up and do this. Politics would have been, no, just let it bleed, let the Democrats die on this. President Trump was trying to be proactive. Was it the greatest plan? No, but it was a starting solution, ladies and gentlemen. I'm here to tell you, this thing is going to absolutely explode. And I said this earlier, when you put special interests, you put these Club for Growth and these PACs, that what we have in Washington, this is what you get. Pay very close attention when I said earlier, who is beholding to the special interests in these PACs. Pay very close attention. That's how you're going to find out who your real candidate is. And it won't be me because nobody owns me.
Thank you, Bruce.
LLOP. I would have recommended supporting the bill. The plan called for reducing regulatory constraints and excessive litigation costs, and that would decrease costs, and that would be a win for everybody. The plan called for a three-step process. The first step was Friday. I hope to see more of an expansion of the single payer option for the insured. This option works well for veterans, Medicare, and Medicaid. Negotiations between insurance companies, doctors, hospitals, and pharmaceutical companies in the past has benefited them as well as Wall Street very well. We need to take a look at how much money is actually being earned at the expense of the everyday Americans. Thank you.
Let's go to table one. We're going to start with Bob Gray, please, Bob. As we're staying on this theme of healthcare, there's obviously no easy answers here. One of the answers proposed by Republicans is insurance across state lines, the ability for insurance companies to do that. Let's talk about that. Would you support that? And would you have supported the bill?
Sure. So to answer your questions directly, absolutely we need competition across state lines. And I would have supported the bill. And let me tell you why. So as an employer of thousands, I understand this from a business point of view and how it constrains hiring and constrains risk-taking. I would be looking for the most conservative bill that could be put on the president's desk. And honestly, I'm a little bit disappointed with the Speaker of the House who couldn't marshal the team to do so. My metaphor for healthcare is automotive insurance. Government tends to overcomplicate things, and what we need is simplicity. So in the automotive insurance industry, you don't insure your spark plugs, you don't insure your oil change, you don't insure your tires, you pay for those things out of pocket. When we introduce choice and free market principles, we always get lower price, better quality, and more access and choice. In addition, we need to pool risk. There's great value to pooling risk, but not as a benefit. I guess in the end, I would come back to what Ronald Reagan said. 80% of something is better than 100% of nothing. And that's why I was so supportive of the bill.
Thank you, Bob. Let's go to your left and talk to Ron from a Democrat. Not a single Democrat supported the bill. Obviously, you would not have. So what would you be changing?
All right, let's keep it real. Let's look at the history. When President Bush was in office and the Republicans controlled the Senate and the House, did they do anything to try to help healthcare? No, there was no legislation, no bills passed. So when Obama came in, he came up with a transformative concept of Obamacare to make sure that people with pre-existing conditions would be covered on their insurance plans. If you remember before the Obamacare, if you had a pre-existing condition or somebody in your family had a pre-existing condition, you couldn't get insurance. We're not going to go back to those days. So even if you're the most strident critic of Obamacare, you've got to give credit that Obama has set this new standard that we're going to make sure that people with pre-existing conditions are covered. For this bill that came up, I would not have supported it. I believe that we should do reforms under the framework of the ACA. I think that's the best way to approach it. I wish we could just take some Republicans and Democrats and lock them in a room and make them talk it out and come up with a bill that would work for everybody. There are reforms that need to be made to ACA. I think selling across state lines is a good concept. But you think about it, on this bill, it's saying that people can opt out of insurance. So if you're healthy and you don't want insurance, but something happens to you, you know that you'll be taken to the emergency room in the hospital and given treatment, and who pays for that? We all end up paying for it anyway. So the concept that everybody should be involved in the insurance pool makes it where unhealthy people and healthy people can all reduce subsidies so we can be covered, and we can't go back to the days. More families went bankrupt in 2009 for medical care. We can't go back to the days where pre-existing conditions are not covered.
Thank you, Ron. Amy?
Thank you. Well, I disagree with a number of you up here, and I do think there's a silver bullet. You make Congress live under the same rules as you and I and all American people, it'll get fixed real quick. That's number one. But we can blame this on Democrats and Republicans. Yes, Democrats crafted it behind closed doors. Paul Ryan did the same thing. He crafted it behind closed doors. I need to set the record straight here. It was not the House Freedom Caucus that brought this down. It was Paul Ryan that brought this down because he should have started with consensus building. It's not the president's responsibility to write legislation and get the caucus on board. It's Paul Ryan's responsibility to do that. And he didn't do that. Not only was the House Freedom Caucus not on board, but moderates weren't on board. And that's why it failed. I would not have supported it because it didn't lower premiums, it didn't lower deductibles, and it didn't lower the cost of prescription drugs. We need that. Not every one of us are a doctor, but every single one of us are a patient, and it affects all of us, and we need to start acting as consumers of healthcare and not just looking at how much insurance costs us. And if I had a card and walked into a grocery store and went to purchase a basket of items and I had to pay $1,000 and didn't know what the cost was before I got to the checkout, and Kurt went into the same grocery store, got the same thing, had a different card and had to pay $10, at some point somebody's gonna be screaming discrimination. We need to act as consumers, and it's time Washington, both the Democrats and Republicans, get their act together, and I really believe that if they live under the same laws as we do, that we will fix this problem. The American consumers are more educated on this issue than any other issue in our lifetime, and so we know what's going on. They can't pull the wool over our eyes.
Thank you. Kurt.
Thank you, Amy. That was well said. And by the way, you always pay less than I do, and I have a problem with that. It's interesting, the debate's about health insurance and not health care, really. And go back to, once again, once you get the government involved in something, things go bad. This goes all the way back to 1942 to the American Emergency Stabilization Act. In 1949% of Americans had health insurance. Because of the wage freeze of 1942, corporations and companies started offering health insurance to incentivize people to come work for them. By 1953, 65% of the American public had health insurance. So what is Obamacare, the Affordable Health Care Act? It's another entitlement. It's another entitlement that we can't afford. That's the first problem. You want to fix health care? Return it between the patient and the doctor. Bring the free markets back into place. It's so simple, it's ridiculous. Get the government out of the business of health care. Get insurance. By the way, this is a simple transaction. I'm in the chicken business, so we'll use example of Amy. If you had to come in and buy one of my chicken sandwiches, on every transaction, you had to have insurance to buy that transaction and to be compensated for it. and you had to have the federal government as part of the guidelines of compensating for that. The cost of that transaction would go dramatically up. That's the analogy of what's happened to healthcare. Healthcare has gotten totally screwed up by the federal government being involved in it. It needs to be devolved. It's the only solution. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's go, Andre Pollard, independent, technology party. It's not funny. I like the technology party.
Yes. So, competition, competition, competition. We all agree that's what the ACA needs right now. And I have a technology solution for you. Simple. We live here in Georgia. There's Georgia Natural Gas, who services the gas, turns it off, and then there's like Scania Energies and the other ones that use that back-end platform. We can do the exact same thing with the ACA. We can make a front-end, technology front-end software, into health, into Medicare, Medicaid, and basically anyone that wants to start a healthcare company with X amount of dollars in bond or whatever can start a health insurance company backed by the ACA and the Medicare and Medicaid platform, right? Simple. They can start off, they can, if we announce this today, there will be 100 companies by tomorrow. And the competition and the shopping for drug prices and the innovation, and eventually we can get these people all off of the back end of the Medicare, Medicaid platform onto their own platform over time. And again, this is the first time you've heard of a solution like that, and that would create competition in state lines and across state lines.
I applaud you for your creativity. I like that. Sounds a little scary with that many new health insurers, but I like the originality. Keith, please.
Yeah, thank you. So I think the range of opinions here shows just how complicated an issue this is. So you look at healthcare, we spend about $3 trillion a year on that. Half of that goes to less than 5% of the people. So it's really how are you going to slice the pie up. So the range of opinions also shows that the ACA has failed us. So the bill that was put forth was a Band-Aid. It was not a replacement. So I think, as Amy mentioned, you need to first make sure that Congress is going to be fall under the laws that they pass. You repeal the ACA fully, and then you start together in a bipartisan fashion. If the bill is going to be better and it's going to make healthcare better for everyone, then Democrats and Republicans are going to have to get on board. You get back to free market principles, you encourage competition, you encourage choice, you create greater transparency in the markets, and you look at the incentives that people have, both on the provider and the patient. When you get those factors working and you have a bill that is actually better healthcare for the American people, you will get that bipartisan support and we'll have greater buy-in, and that's what we need in the political process now. Thank you.
Keith, thanks so much. We're going to go all the way to the other end. We're going to go all the way down to William Lopp at table three. We talked about this on Money Matters on WSB Radio this weekend, where I believe if you ask 10 folks about healthcare, your opinion, you will get 10 different answers, or in this case, 18 for 18. I would suspect, though, under tax reform, we have a little bit more agreement, at least maybe from each party, and we won't get 18 different answers. So let's move to that. Let's start with you, William. There is great talk of healthcare reform. There's the Ryan plan, the GOP plan that's been widely published at abetterway.gop. There's Trump's plan. President Trump has modified his plan twice. The two plans are fairly similar. And that today is the new big debate in Washington as healthcare to some extent is on the back burner. So let's talk about tax reform. What do you support about? Let's start with corporate taxes, which is a big part of that plan, among many others, and we'll talk about all the different pieces of it, but let's start with corporate. Do you support lowering corporate taxes from 35 to 15 here in the U.S.?
Yeah, thank you. Decreasing corporate income taxes from 35, I think the top rate's 39% in certain categories.
Right, if you count
regardless,
all the other state taxes.
Regardless, Trump is talking about a 15% reduction. We should begin with the corporate tax rate down to 25%. This brings us on average with everybody across the planet. The average global tax rate is 25%. Let's get there. These companies want to come to the US and let's give them 25%. If the spike in relocations does not take place, then we can bring the rate down another notch. No use giving up the farm on our first go round. but reducing corporate tax rate, sure, 25 points.
Thank you. To the right, please. Let's go to Bruce.
I believe in getting rid of all the taxes.
You're here. Just all of them?
Okay. Get rid of all of them.
I would think that at least get a
pause. No, the reason why I say that is because, you know, small business, that's what I am, been there for 25 years. We make up 80% of the nation's tax service is what they collect from 80% of the small people. You know, inventory tax, sales tax, payroll tax, ad valorem tax, occupational tax, alarm fee tax. Guys, I paid 37% on my business last year, and it's killing the small business. There's no small business growth. I know a lot of bankers want to see that, which I have more time to talk about Dodd-Frank, which I'm very optimistic that's going to be really good with the president's going to bring forward. But that's how we grow our economy. We got to attack all the taxes, especially take care of our small business. We are actually dying, and we're taking care of all these entitlements and these programs on our backs. So I respectfully, yes, the corporate tax, I'd like to see it go down as the president implemented. Thank God we have a lot of business people that are going to be serving in these cabinets. They're going to be these ambassadors and everything and leadership around the cabinet, which I'm very optimistic. They're not pay-to-play people. There's no favors that they had to get from the president to get where they're at. They're actually people that he chose that are vetted in the private sector. They're going to bring good private experience to the government sector, and I'm very optimistic about it. Thank you.
Thanks, Bruce. I'm interested to hear from you, Rebecca, about this tax reform. I know that, again, this is mostly Republican talking points of reform. As a Democrat, where do you stand?
Well, I agree with one thing that then-candidate Trump said, is that we should reduce corporate taxes to get corporations to move back to the United States. That would motivate them to return and hopefully stay. But I don't think big corporations actually pay that much taxes. Their effective tax rate is significantly lower than we think. A 15% tax rate would do probably nothing as far as stimulating the economy. We had the attempt.
How much lower, by the way? What would you say the effective tax rate is for maybe, bigger corporations?
I would say 30%, bring it down some. But I think that, you know, reducing taxes doesn't necessarily do anything to stimulate the economy, and that money does not trickle down to employees' benefits, increased salaries, and their ability to spend more and, you know, again, generate taxes. You know, the average salary in this country is $57,000 a year, with 75% of people living paycheck to paycheck, and they're paying way more their fair share of taxes. They need relief. We need to relieve the people that are trying to balance their budget, pay their bills, put their kids through college, and save for retirement, rather than worry about big corporations that some pay no taxes at all.
Thank you, Rebecca. We moved to Judson Hill. Judson, there's a lot of the table here between corporate, individual. What do you think the best part of the reform would be?
Well, thank you all very much. As your Senate Finance Chairman for the last 4 years, I have a lot of experience in this area especially. But you gotta start with the fundamental question is why are we taxing in the first place? Corporate, personal, whatever. Why are we taxing? And that's to produce revenue to deliver the core functions of our government. I think we're out of control as a government. I think we spend way too much. I think we're involved in certain programs and services we have no right to be involved in, and government regulations are strangling small business. I believe in the fair tax, frankly, because you get to all different areas of our economy, including those that are on a cash basis. And I've had the track record of doing it. I've been part of the leadership team here in Georgia that's helped create the environment to grow and develop lots of jobs in Georgia, over 500,000 new jobs, and also make Georgia the number one place in the nation to do business the last 4 years. I'm starting to sound like a broken record, I think, but I've got the proven track record to do this. We have delivered on these reforms. We need to lower the corporate income tax, but we need to lower the corporate tax. Moreover, we need to lower the tax on small businesses and individuals, because you know best how to save, invest, and spend your own money, and not government. Thank you.
Thanks, Judson. Richard Keeley.
Yes, I'm going to go out on a limb here and say that I would agree with Bruce if we were to address the entire tax structure. So these don't exist in and of themselves. So the current plan, the last one I saw, unless it changed this morning, was reduces revenues by $9.4 million over the next 10 years, even as they're claiming to want to balance the budget. So there's a systemic problem here of not looking for a just solution that addresses
the needs of the government that we all believe we need. I have not met one person, Republican or Democrat, that believes that we need to cut the education, the funding of our schools. And yet, we're taking the parsley off of the Grand Slam breakfast when we have high cholesterol and saying that we're doing that in the sake of fiscal conservatism. What we've done is, what's been offered is a giant tax cut for the wealthy, when I think we need to address the fundamental fairness of the system.
Alexander Hernandez. We're talking about, again, as an independent, do you support these lower taxes? What piece of the legislation or potential legislation would you support? Corporate, individual, repatriation, which we could talk about, of taxes, or would you rather see tax rates go up?
A short answer for corporate tax rates, no cut there. And I'll tell you why. We've seen a massive redistribution of wealth going from working class, middle class folks upward to the top earners over the past 40 years, and that has hurt working families. As one of the only working class candidates up here, that's vital for me, and that's why I got in this race, because I knew these issues would be ignored had I not participated. There was a huge story last year that broke that unfortunately got overlooked by the presidential race, and it's the Panama Papers. We saw what happens when folks try to avoid taxes, and these are the same sort of level of folks we're talking about, the top earners, the corporate tax folk that we're trying to cut. They stash their money abroad. So what that means is, regardless, you cut the taxes lower, they're still going to take surplus and stash it abroad. Certain folks, not everyone, obviously, but that is, and last figure I saw, we're talking about half GDP, essentially, just going to be stashed, never going to be taxed. So with that regard, I would say no to those sort of taxes, and anything that we can do to relieve working class folks, middle class folks who've been squeezed for far too long in this country, and that's why I'm in this race.
Thank you. Let's go to table two. John Ossoff, let's go back to you in the center here. I'm just going to quote something that you said or paraphrase. You advocate that it's wrong to balance tax cuts on the back of the most vulnerable. So what do you mean by that?
Well, when I talk to small and medium-sized business owners, they want efficiency and simplicity, they want certainty, and they want a level playing field. If we are going to embark upon tax reform to improve the efficiency and simplicity of the tax code, to improve American competitiveness, the rewards of that reform should not flow only to the largest organizations, but also to small and medium-sized businesses that have difficulty raising capital, developing products, and competing with established firms.
So you're saying that if you lower corporate tax rates, you would want to lower them too for small businesses?
Well, to the extent there is tax reform, for example, to eliminate carve-outs and special treatment in the tax code. And the tax code is quite complex because large organizations with access to Congress have been able to manipulate it over a long period of time. And the tax reform process should seek to remove those instances of special treatment in order to ensure that there is a level playing field. That process should benefit smaller organizations and not just those large institutions and trade groups that have extraordinary access to congressional committees. And to your question, I think that a country says a lot about its values and priorities by how it balances its books. And as we seek to achieve fiscal responsibility, to do so on the backs of folks who have no voice, low-income children or seniors, I think reflects the wrong set of priorities. And we absolutely can find ways to tighten the belt in the federal government, but we can do so without imposing those costs on folks who don't have a lot of room before they're in difficulty.
So again, do you support these lower, again, in general, if you look at the tax proposal that is on the table to some extent, the blueprint at least, you do not support lowering taxes in any of those categories?
I don't know about any of those categories or the specific proposal you're referring to, but as a general principle, I'm all for improving our competitiveness by making the tax code simpler, more efficient, and leveling the playing field. I think the most important work of tax reform is to eliminate the loopholes and the extraordinary treatment that large organizations and trade groups receive.
Thank you. Karen Handel, I'd like you to answer really the same question.
Sure. You know, what's been proposed is broad, comprehensive tax reform that is going to provide tax relief not just to large corporations, but to small and medium companies, as well as to individuals by going from 7 brackets down to 3. So that's broad, comprehensive tax relief for virtually every single person in this room and across the 6th district. At the same time, Having pro-growth policies such as tax reform and lower taxes, that will be a massive injection into our economy. We need to stimulate the economy and have a growth rate at a much higher percentage than what we're currently seeing. Imagine if we can get the growth rate up into 4% range, 5%, how much relief that is on the side of cutting the budget, etc. At the same time, you know, we have had in the 6th District a pretty good economic recovery, but it's not great. The recovery was more of a reset or a recalibration, if you will, because after post the Great Recession, salaries for most people have still not really recovered fully. And being able to have solid tax relief for corporations, small, medium, and large, and individuals will be an incredible injection and allow us to really stimulate our economy in a way that's going to let us fully recover and create more jobs and more innovation and more R&D, and then it just grows and grows from there. So yes, I support it completely.
All right, thank you. Let's move again to your right, David.
So my opinion about taxes and the tax code, I agree with part of what John said, that the tax code is way too complex. Complexity is a subsidy. It's a way for special interests to get in there and have their special favors for their particular interests. It breeds corruption in Washington, and a simplified tax code would go a long way to reducing corruption in Washington. In terms of the corporate tax rate, I do think it needs to be reduced. We've talked about the competitiveness for large businesses, but also, as a CPA, I can tell you, most small businesses file as flow-through entities, as I'm sure most of y'all know, LLCs, S-Corps. Now, if we can reduce the corporate tax rate, then small businesses can start filing as C-Corps, and they can be taxed at a lower level, and they're going to leave the money in the business. Because right now, you're taxed at a personal level at every dollar of profit. If you can be taxed at a lower level, if you leave the money in the business, that'll help small businesses grow, and that'll be really good for the economy. One last thing. When I started my business, I wasn't, you know, we were having the debate. Obama wanted to raise the top tax rate to 39.6%, it was 35. When I started my business, it was the regulation that was keeping me down. It was the regulation that was making it hard to grow. My thought was, get the government out of my way, get the EPA out of my way. If I ever make it to the top tax bracket, I'll pay an extra 5%. I think regulations is a first priority before the individual tax rate.
Thank you. Dr. Muhammad Ali Bouyan, you're an economist. Let's hear your thoughts on lower taxation. What part of this proposal would make sense?
Well, before I say that, it's interesting how hypocritical we become. We talk about vulnerables when we accept $3 million and already being sold out to special back Mr. John Ossoff. So I find that very ironic. The problem with that is that we take too much money and become part of the special interest group's control, and we can't do nothing about it. And I am one of the candidates that have rejected any special interest group. In terms of tax, yes, I have a PhD in economics, I have two MBAs, I have been a professor of entrepreneurship, consulted with small businesses and many young people, and I know what the regulation does. And in terms of tax, the bipartisan committee estimated that 8.9 billion hours are wasted every year on the stocks, what deductions, and we waste about $430 billion every year. So we do need a comprehensive tax reform. In terms of the current proposal, I do support the tax in cut, but as long as it is linked to job creation. So those companies should be held accountable, whatever tax break they're taking. They should be able to prove that they are investing and creating new jobs. And the best way to cut deficit and reduce the government spending is to create new jobs, which will help the overall economy. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Let's go to Reagan Edwards, please, down to the end of the table. Same question, Reagan. We're really talking about, from your perspective as a Democrat, do you support these tax cuts?
I don't support tax cuts for large corporations. I think for small and medium-sized businesses, that should definitely be on the table. These businesses employ the majority of Americans, and from what I've seen, they tend to add to the quality of life of the majority of Americans. So I definitely support their growth in America. I will say that the tax reform that's been submitted, I'll say, it does go from 7 brackets to 3, and I'm surprised no one on this panel has said anything about it, but for that current tax bracket for the middle class, that 125K, it will increase your tax rate. So for middle class Americans, like myself and probably a few people on this panel, your tax rate will go up. So no, I do not support it at all. I believe that even in that tax bracket, we need relief as well. And I don't support anything that will stagnate or slow down the growth of the middle class.
Thank you, Reagan. Dan Moody, please.
Thank you, Wes. What has not been mentioned so far is it's been since 1986 since we've had major tax reform in this country. We've been delinquent in not doing that sooner. And where I would love to start is with the IRS. There's an agency that's totally out of control. Look at the money that this country can save if they get that agency out of control. The president has said that he's going to make sure there are massive tax cuts. He said this when he addressed Congress. There's going to be massive tax reforms for the middle class. What that means, and many of you fall into that category with small businesses, that frees up capitals. It allows you to hire more people. And when that happens, the economy just gets a whole lot better. I'm all for tax reform. I think it's long overdue, and it's time to do it. And there's a host of regulations we can eliminate to start on that process. Thank you, Wes.
Thank you. Let's move to table one here with, well, let's start with you, Ron. Again, from your perspective on tax reform, lower individual tax rates, lower corporate tax rates.
So when I was in the state Senate, I authored one of the largest tax cuts in the state's history. It ended up being the tax that we took off of food items in the grocery store. And that's been in effect for 20 years. So it's interesting, as a Democrat, I have a record of reducing state taxes more than any of the Republicans up on this dais. Thank you. Go ahead and clap. Thanks. So yeah, the bigger issue
that we're... That's good.
I got one. Okay. The two. Okay, there we go. So the bigger issue is about how do we balance the budget? Okay, we're running a $400 billion budget deficit. So in the state Senate, by Georgia law, we have to have a balanced budget up every year. We've got to have that same attitude in Washington. So before we give corporate tax breaks, which I'm open to it, but we've got to get a handle on the budget. So the effective rate of corporate tax is about 20% right now. So let's balance the budget. Let's make the cuts we have to make to get to the balanced budget. Then we can start, at least we know how much revenue we have coming in now, and we can work on the budget. Once we get to the budget, or actually get to surplus, then we can start looking at tax changes.
Thank you, Ron. To your right, Bob. Bob Gray.
Thank you. So to answer your question, absolutely reduce the corporate income tax rate, implement a fair tax, and repatriate the trillion or 2 trillion or whatever the number is from overseas profits back here into this country.
Wait, hold on. So you're saying a flat tax though?
I said fair tax.
Oh, fair tax. Okay.
So having led global businesses and been to 34 countries, I think I have a unique perspective on this. What's the objective? The objective is to maximize global trade. Milton Friedman said something I thought was pretty powerful. He said, capitalism has lifted more people out of poverty than any other system in the history of man. And that's absolutely true. But we need global trade as long as we have a level playing field. And that requires consistent tax policy and consistent regulatory policy. So as it relates to corporate income tax, I'd like to move it from 35% to as close to zero as we can, implement a fair tax, repatriate the trillion or so. What happens then is we immediately return profits to shareholders, we increase wages, as we saw in the 1920s and 1980s when we had major tax reform, and then companies reinvest in capital and equipment, and that just grows the economy, and we have a more vital and prosperous country.
Thank you, Bob. Andre?
Yes. So the fact is we have our large telecom, technology companies going overseas to Europe to start up headquarters over there. and a lot of it is just a skeleton office doing nothing just to get that tax bracket. So obviously our system of whatever 30, whatever percent is way too high. So, you know, I could see something coming down to more like a 25% flat tax, no deductions, period.
Thank you, Andre. Keith, please.
Well, I think the most important question is, where is the most efficient place to deploy capital? Do you believe that's with the government, or do you believe it's with businesses and individuals? I believe it's with businesses and individuals. So I absolutely believe tax reform is one of the best things we can do to promote economic growth. I think we do need to look at lowering individual rates. We definitely need to lower rates on small businesses to promote the growth of small business and promote economic or global competitiveness with our large corporations. You know, when you hear somebody on the left talk about we don't want to put this on the backs of poor children or families, I think that fails to understand the power of capitalism and the effectiveness that deploying that capital with you and with your businesses can have on lifting all boats.
Thank you, Keith. Let's go to Amy to finish the, Amy, then Kurt to finish this question up on taxes.
Thank you. I'm going to disagree with...
Not to read up just a second. Just remember, too, if you're still here and you have Twitter account, at the hashtag here is at GA District 6. If you hear something on stage you like or you dislike, just remember to tweet that. There's a page here, a small card with different Twitter handles. And you can always at real Donald Trump if you want the president to be paying attention. Amy, I'm sorry, continue.
Thank you. I'm going to disagree with Bob Gray. He said the objective is to increase global trade. I completely disagree. The objective is to put the American people first. We've got too many globalists in Washington that's all they're focused on, and that's why the middle class and small businesses have suffered across this country for the past number of years, and that's exactly what Donald Trump campaigned on, and that's why he was able to penetrate that blue wall in Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, and Ohio. I believe in tax reform. I think it needs to be overall comprehensive tax reform policy. And I think you can start actually with repealing Obamacare. That's the first huge tax cut that would go to the American people. But I do think that if you lower the corporate tax rate, and if Democrats and Republicans work together, and I do believe that they can do it with good leadership, I believe that it's going to instill certainty and confidence in businesses again, and that they will reinvest in their employees. They pay their employees. They will hire the unemployed, the underemployed. And what's going to happen is people are going to inject their money that's in their pocket because they can spend it better than the government into the economy, and I think it's gonna definitely give our economy a boom, and I think that's exactly what needs to happen.
Thanks, Amy. Kurt?
So I've seen a lot of people walk in and out of the room. A lot of people left in the last 16, 17 presentations, and I don't blame you why. Because I remember my bio is a regular person, so I'm just going to tell you exactly the way I think most of you would talk about this issue. This country was founded basically by the stimulus, the act of taxation without representation. It's what created the ethos for us to get this country started. And so we're at that place again. 104 years ago, we passed an amendment to the Constitution. It's called the 16th Amendment. It was a progressive tax system. It was 400 pages long. That tax document and the appendices now are 76,000 pages long. The problem with the current debate, Wes, is even though we're talking about taking 7 brackets to 3, we're adding more goodies to try to seduce you as the American voter to get support of it instead of doing what we really need to do, which is to bring a real tax system back into place that serves the American people and serves the American economy. We're talking about reformations, what real people want. You don't want to be continued to seduced by more goodies from Washington. That's what's happening today. Whether you're on the left or on the right, same thing happens regardless of administration. It's time for real tax reform, like our forefathers would have done the same thing. It's time for tax reform. It means appeal the 60th Amendment and replace it with a flat tax or a fair tax. I make a case for both. I can make a case for both being revenue neutral, but that's where the robust debate needs to be had. Thank you.
Thank you, Kurt. Okay, we're running out of time. It's 1:30 already. So, let's try to keep these responses to under a minute. Let's shoot for 45 seconds. I'll start with you, Bruce, on your end here. Because we're talking in the 6th district, this should be an easy question. If you could do or have one policy that most impacts your constituents here in the 6th District, what would that policy be, Bruce?
Well, like I said all along, everyone's talking, the other candidates keep talking the same old, but I came out the gate talking about transportation. And, you know, we have a very good blessing in the metro Atlanta area. We have the fastest growing businesses in Atlanta. We have the largest airport. But we also rated number one worst traffic corridor as of February 25th in the nation. So you need a champion that can understand transportation. Like I said, I was chairman for MARTA for 5 years, 3 years out of five. I've traveled the country to understand all types of mobility, bus, rapid transit, light rail, heavy rail, et cetera, multi-lanes, et cetera. And I bring a wealth of experience to that. But what I bring with that is the fact that I do know the president very well, the family, everyone in the administration are very close to me in terms of, especially during the campaign. Y'all know how rough the campaign was, but we made it. The other thing, too, that I bring is the relationship with Transportation Secretary Chao and all the other members. That's a wealth of experience that I could bring to bring back those tax dollars back here to the region. You had T-Splosh, you had all these other things, but you didn't have the real hammer at the table, and that's me.
Thank you, Bruce Lavella, hammer. Let's go next to the right. Dr. Quick, please.
Thank you. For those of you who have lived in other major cities, you may realize that Atlanta is very much in need in a rapid, clean energy transportation system. The 6th District can't get downtown Atlanta without, you know, plowing through six lanes of traffic. Adding more lanes and repairing the roads isn't the answer. We need a rapid, clean energy transportation system that'll put engineers, technology, construction workers, and staffers to work, not only in building the system, but in maintaining it. That needs to widen the north-south corridor and east-west. There's no reason that we shouldn't have this. Our president has stated both in the campaign and now that he wants an infrastructure bill. When I go to Congress, I'm going to fight for those federal dollars to bring that money to Atlanta to reduce pollution, traffic, and smog over our city. Thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca. Judson Hill.
Thank you all very much. I would deal with Obamacare. I'd repeal Obamacare and implement an affordable healthcare system that's patient-focused and allows the patient to control the dollars, which allows you to buy insurance across state lines and deals with pre-existing conditions. And secondly, I would deal with transportation to cut the congestion that really hurts families and small businesses and large businesses. But I think the decision in this race is extremely clear. It's a decision between us and the Republicans and the Democrats. Which Republican candidate here can win and will win in November, and not in November, but also on April 18th, as well as probably on June 20th. Fox News poll said I'm the Republican candidate, the only Republican candidate who will win this race and who will defeat the Democrat. That's important because Nancy Pelosi is coming hard to win the seat back. I'm a proven conservative reformer. I've delivered on those issues that matter to you. I've stood up for you every time I had the chance on health care, tax reform, cutting regulations and strengthening our immigration policies and standing up for our military, including our men and women out of Dobbins Air Force Base. Thanks.
Thank you, Judson. Richard Keatley, please.
I mentioned I'm going to emphasize three things: education, national security, and the jobs of the future. I'm going to leave out the transportation, which I believe a lot of us agree on. That is the number one problem probably here in the perimeter corridor. And talk about education. As I mentioned, our schools in Georgia are 32nd in the nation, and the United States is 14th to 19th in the world. This is largely because of the disparity in our education system, which is based mainly on local funding. And this is a deterrent to economic growth as well as to the functioning of our democracy. Ignorance breeds bad government. So I believe strongly that I would work to introduce an education reform bill that would address those disparities in education.
Thank you, Richard. Alexander Hernandez.
Well, I believe my platform itself addresses core things that would help everyone in the district, but I'm going to take this opportunity to bring up another plan. It would be modeled after the Republicans of Alaska. They have what they call the Alaska Permanent Fund and the Alaska Dividend. We could implement something like that nationally, and it would help every single person here in Georgia's 6th Congressional District. No one would be left behind, and this is a plan that would be inclusive and like answering like the question you stated. How can we help everyone in the district? And this is one way we can.
Where would the money come from?
Well, that would come from all sorts of resources. The way they do it in Alaska is the Exxon surpluses are implemented into the permanent fund. We would do something along those lines. All the nuts and bolts are still to be figured out. That's something that I would like to pursue with a consensus across the political spectrum.
Okay.
Thank you.
But, I believe we need also William, please. William Lott.
Thank you. The number one issue is to reduce the size of government. We can reduce the size of government by paying a fair wage. Back when I graduated from high school, $2.90 an hour. Put the formula in the CPI today, it's $9.70 an hour. Pay a man $9.70 an hour, he doesn't qualify for the government welfare programs, he gets the self-respect that he deserves, and we just reduce the size of government because we don't need those workers anymore. Immigration reform. These people have been here 20 years. We've been educating them. And now we're doing a fear factor in America, trying to say, gee, you're an illegal immigrant. Come on, you've been part of us for 20 years. Don't look over your shoulder. Let's give them a pass of legal, a path of legal status. Legal status, with legal status, just they would never be allowed to vote. Go to my website, there's plenty out there for that. Thank you so much.
William, thank you, sir. Well, let's go to table one here. I want to start with Amy Kramer for you. And I want to answer, I want you to please answer the same question here. If you could do one thing for the district here, policy, if you end up in Washington, what would it be?
Well, actually, I'm going to give you two real quick. Tax reform, I think corporate and personal tax reform is needed in this district. I think it would put people back to work and it would affect all income classes. I also think that we have, some of you may be familiar with the Black Triangle. That's the triangle, that the story that's been done about the heroin problem we have and opioids. That's a huge issue here, but not across the country. And I think that the way to deal with that is secure our border and stop the drugs coming into this country. And I think that there are many families, many of you probably have been touched by that crisis, and I think that that's something that needs to be addressed also.
All right, Amy, thank you. But let's go, well, let's go to the left here for Kurt.
Thanks, Wes. I guess the first thing I would do legislatively is I would make sure that there was a law passed in Congress that everybody had to listen to the Wes Moss show on Saturday mornings.
You've got my vote.
Okay, thank you, excellent. The first and foremost priority for the American people is a little radical. But it's a term limit, it's a constitutional limit for term limits on the members of the United States House of Representatives and United States Senate. Because without it, there's not going to be the political will or courage to reverse the $20 trillion of national debt, balance the budget ongoing with a surplus, truly repeal the 16th Amendment and have true tax reform, and fourth, most important, and this affects everybody in this room, is to begin to defund the federal bureaucracy that's literally stretching. It's killing us freedom-wise. And the one most important thing to all of us as Americans in the 6th District is the issue of freedom. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's go to Ron, please.
So the 6th District is one of the most vibrant districts in the country. And a lot of people here are with different chambers of commerce. So when we're talking to companies to attract them into this 6th District, the things that companies are looking for is access to public transportation. They want world-class schools. They want green space, clean air, clean water, and green space. And they also want, the clean air and transportation and the education. So if you look at companies like Mercedes moved into Sandy Springs to be close to public transportation. State Farm moved into Perimeter to be close to public transportation. So that's a key element. As we want to attract new companies into the 6th District, we've got to work on those issues, and those are also the issues that help people that live in the district. So I live, work, raise my family, my kids go to public school in the district. And these are the most important issues that will help the people of the 6th District.
Ron, thank you. Bob Gray, please.
Well, three things. So first, the tax reform and deregulation would benefit Georgia and the 6th District generally. Infrastructure. We need a multimodal transportation solution for Metro Atlanta. And I would emphasize the flexible solutions that have higher return on investment, like bus rapid transit, and investing in the technology that will support the autonomous vehicles that every automotive company has said are going to be here pretty soon. And the third thing is national security. The F-22 has been ground to a halt. I'd like to see the Lockheed Martin plant back online and how that would translate to a growth in jobs here in the 6th District. And lastly, cybersecurity. We've got to invest in cybersecurity. I think Georgia Tech graduates are a tremendous source of talent to help Michael Rogers, Director of NSA and Cyber Command, to get the job done.
Thank you. Andre.
So I think a lot of us agree in the infrastructure. It's, you know, the traffic and the transportation here is, it costs us a lot of money in energy and everything. But technology, again, coming to the rescue, right? As Bob mentioned, autonomous driving cars, apps to help you with better routes, you know, everything technology-wise, you know, the robotics, the training for the future workforce also, you know, there's, you know, he mentioned Georgia Tech, artificial intelligence, big data. I mean, all of these things are our future, right? We don't like to do stuff. We want our robot to do it for us, right? So someone's got to service those robots. Let it be us. Let us get the companies going. Let us get the startups going. Thank you.
Thank you, Andre. Keith.
Thanks. So I just would like to point out that, remember, when somebody gets to Congress, they're going to represent the 6th District. But really, the body comes together for the betterment of the whole country, and that's really important. So I'm not going to commit to some specific project in this 6th District, because it's really a question of what should our federal government be involved in. I believe at its core, we should be protecting the people and providing justice. So in that light, based on my military and foreign policy experience, the thing that I would like to work on it first is ensuring we continue to protect the American people through ensuring we have the strongest military in the world, by having a common sense immigration policy, and by ensuring that we once again take a leadership role in the country, in the world, because I believe the world is a safer place when America leads from the front.
Thank you, Keith. We're going to go to table two in the center here to finish. This is our last table to answer a final question, as it's already 1:45. I want to respect everyone's time today. Let's start on the left side with Reagan. Reagan, again, let's continue with this line. I think it's a good way to wrap up today about specifically the district here in the 6th District. If you could do one thing in Congress, if you get there, what would it be?
First, I'd like to thank everyone for coming. I know this has been a long forum, but I do appreciate you coming to listen. If there's one thing that I can do for the 6th District, that's open up transparency. And by opening up transparency, I mean that any member of the 6th District should be able to contact their elected official, let them know how they want to vote on any specific bill going before Congress, and not only that, get that information reported back to them. We should know the percentage of the people in our district that want us to vote yay or nay on a certain topic. Right now we have people calling phones and supposedly there's somebody checking a box, and you know, that's how it's done. But in a day and age when we can do our banking online, we can file our taxes online, why don't we have that transparency? And I call all of the candidates on this stage to agree with me and to promise that you will open up transparency to the people of the 6th District. That's what we need. We live in a digital age, we need to act like it.
That's time. Thank you, Reagan, I appreciate it. Let's move to your right, Dan Moody.
Thank you, Wes. They warned us at this table to be very careful about standing up, because there's not much room between these chairs. So I'm glad we've got a doctor in the house. So if I keel over,
Bob, if you fall back, this video would probably go viral. So it'd be once world
I'm not going to do that. If I had one and only one thing that I could accomplish in Congress, it would be all about term limits. There's a lot of people in this campaign talking about it. They're talking the talk. I've walked the walk. I term limited myself. I went back home. I lived under the laws that I helped create. Imagine if we got rid of career politicians in Washington. Thank you, Wes. You've done a great job.
Thank you, Dan. John Ossoff, please.
Yes, sir. Well, we've discussed infrastructure a great deal. And of course, as growing organizations consider where to place new facilities, where to make investments, they want places where overheads will be low, where they can move goods and services efficiently, where they can retain talent by offering a high standard of living. And we also need to think a bit bigger. Georgia hosts the busiest airport in the world, the Port of Savannah, has the potential to be a logistics hub on the East Coast. that attracts more and more commerce to flow through Metro Atlanta. And if we want to build this community into an economic powerhouse that is the envy of the rest of the country, we need to have an ambitious vision for making sure that Georgia is the most important hub for logistics, the movement of goods, services, and financial services on the Eastern Seaboard.
Thank you, John. Karen?
Thank you. Thank you again for giving us this opportunity. The most important thing that I can do as your next congressman is to be the fiercest advocate I possibly can be for the overall interests of the 6th District. Secondly, to keep my commitment and deliver. Whether the issue is repealing and replacing Obamacare, comprehensive tax reform so we can grow this economy, reducing regulation so we can get that off the backs of small, medium, and large companies, balancing the budget to stop the hemorrhaging and tackle that debt. Keep promises. I have a track record of actually delivering in the jobs you have given me the privilege of holding. As your next congressman, I will deliver. Thank you again. I ask for your vote, but I'm gonna work hard to earn it.
Karen, thanks so much. David.
So I think people in the 6th District are worried about a lot of the same issues that people all over the country are worried about. We have to have fiscal sanity. We have to get our debt under control. We need an entrepreneurial society. We need a growing economy so we can create jobs. But something specifically that I think that I can help with, the pollution in Atlanta is worse than it is in most cities in this country. And yes, I'm a Republican. And so I ran a business where we helped convert vehicles to run on a cleaner fuel to help with pollution, 90% reduction in particle pollution. That's reducing the smog. There are free market solutions to helping with pollution, to helping the environment. I figured them out. I never took a dollar of government money. Those programs were unsustainable. They're free market answers. And that's an industry that I think can flourish in this city. To be honest with you, that's why I ended up having my business in this city. It's a great city to do it. It's a great city to expand those technologies and helping to clean the environment. Thank you.
David, thank you. Dr. Muhammad Ali Bouillon, our last response for the day.
Thank you.
Maybe.
Well, as a professor of entrepreneurship, I had the opportunity to travel around the world. I have access to entrepreneurial community around the globe, very successful entrepreneurial group. So one of the things I will be able to do is to attract them to come to 6th District to actually create new high-paying jobs for the people in the district. So that would be the single most. Having said that, I would also like to promise that my main point is that two things: we need to get rid of the career politician, and we need to get rid of people who are already being sold out to special interest group. So you need to elect someone who has the honesty and integrity to serve you in the Congress. Muhammad Ali, top of the ballot, please vote for me on the 18th. Thank you.
Thank you, candidate. Go over 15 seconds times 18 is a fairly large number. However, we did publish, BrandBank very, I think, intelligently published a guide with all the candidates' answers. So there's several questions we didn't get to today. We didn't get to the border adjustment tax, which we wanted to talk about. We wanted to talk about the role of potentially the press. I was going to do a one-word question about your thought about Donald Trump and Twitter. We don't have time to do it. There will be a recap on Money Matters from 8 to 9:30 Sunday morning on WSB Radio. What we learned today, though, is I think what we all know why this job is so difficult is that the question about healthcare is extraordinarily diverse, and it's hard to get an answer, and it's such a personal issue for so many of us that there's a reason it's a difficult reform in Washington. Most of these folks seem to want lower taxes. I don't want to quote all of you on that, though. And it looks as though we all need transportation. We need transportation help in the 6th District. By the way, WSB Radio loves the traffic jam clog issue because it's a lot of drive time listening for Eric Erickson in the evening, so, and now Mark Arum. So WSB Radio still likes transportation issues. In seriousness, though, thank you all for being here. Of course, this very important special election is April 18th coming up. Of course, we'll be there to vote. for those of you who live in the district. Logistically, candidates, before we even get up, and while we're applauding you all today, if you can just come out this way and go right, if you can come out this way behind me through that door down to the green room. So we've got press here that obviously will want to talk to all of you. So with that, thank you. Enjoy the rest of this day. Thanks so much for being here.
No, I didn't notice that.